and thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. Empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise is one of the things I'm extremely passionate about. That is why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends to the staffing industry. Today, I have the pleasure of speaking with Jason Turner. Jason is a chief investment strategist of Great Lakes Advisors. He's a member of the firm's investment committee, authors, market and economic commentary, regularly presents in the media and to professional conferences, and works with client portfolios, managers to support institutional and private clients. As the head of multi-asset strategy, he is responsible for portfolio strategy, asset allocation, and for overseeing the firm's manager due diligence and selection efforts. He is also a member of the firm's operating committee and management committee. I've had the pleasure of hearing Jason present at many Staffing State Association conferences this past year. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Jason Turner. Welcome, Jason.
Thank you very much.
No, it's great to be here. Good. Thank you. So, Jason, can you start with the current environment and what the year-end forecast looks like for the not just for staffing, but for everybody?
Sure. From a broad economic perspective, we've had a surprisingly strong year of growth so far year to date in 2023. I think if you ask most economists or prognosticators at the beginning of the year, that we'd already be in recession at this point of the year, looking from the end of last year forward. As we moved in this year, though, the American consumers proved to be a lot more resilient, a significant amount more spending still going on in the economy from that consumer. And consumer spending drives some 70% of our economic growth. So with the consumer still strong and employment market still very strong, evidenced by a 3.8% unemployment rate most recently for the month of September, and we're seeing some strong economic conditions for 2023. Now, as we look forward from here, we look towards the end of the year, I would anticipate that we're going to see, once announced, third quarter GDP growth, a very strong result for the third quarter as consumers continue to spend, particularly in July. We've started to see some change in behaviors. We've moved into September, and now into October, we continue to see a little bit more change. That change we're seeing at the end of the quarter and the beginning of here of the fourth quarter likely means the fourth quarter comes in a little lower than the third quarter. So still a strong year of economic growth in 2023, but evidence, I think, once we get to the end of the fourth quarter, that the economy started to slow. And that'll likely continue into 2024.
Okay. What is your insight on what the staffing industry has seen in 2023? Because we've actually seen a slowdown in the staffing world. We have definitely seen anywhere from a 15 to 20% year-over-year slowdown comparison there. So can you put any insight on that?
Absolutely. And while, you know, my comments just a moment ago on the broad economy underscore economic strength, that doesn't mean that we aren't seeing cracks in different areas of the economy. And as I've said before and in different presentations to the staffing industry, I treat the staffing industry almost as my canary in the coal mine. That things typically happen to those in the staffing industry and you see things earlier than we do in the rest of the economy. And that's both a positive and a negative. So going into an economic slowdown, you typically feel it first. Coming out of an economic slowdown, you usually feel that pickup early if you've prepared yourself for success. So what sort of cracks am I seeing in employment markets? Where we've had an over demand for employment really dating back to the pre-pandemic years. I think we crossed over job openings being greater than available job seekers. So assuming everybody in the unemployment market was able to find a job, we still would have been short in 2017 and 2018. We got a brief respite from that during the pandemic year, and then it re-accelerated pretty quickly. We currently sit with a meaningful difference in the number of job openings versus the available labor. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that labor is correctly matched. Somebody in technology is not apt to take a job in leisure and hospitality. And that's at least those two industries have been part of that dynamic that we've seen this year. If you're in technology, if you're in manufacturing, light industrial, if you're in any of those business services areas, that hiring has slowed significantly where American businesses started to anticipate, hey, we're going to have an economic slowdown. Let's slow our rate of hiring in anticipation that maybe we'll let some attrition take care of right-sizing as opposed to massive layoffs when we do end up in recession. Those service-oriented businesses, particularly, again, technology and business services, and those manufacturing services that are not going to produce the goods that we saw them producing in 2021, they slowed their rates of hiring early this year. And that has a direct impact, obviously, on the staffing industry. Those areas where you don't see a lot of staffing industry, you don't see a lot of staffing firms staffing for restaurants or hotels and housekeeping services, those have been the areas that we've really seen a jump in employment this year. So while that employment number has been fairly stable on a headline basis, we are definitely seeing some change and shifting sands underneath it that are going to take a few more quarters to work their way through.
Yeah, it's interesting from people who are not in the staffing industry for them to understand why we're down. It's exactly what you're saying is people don't understand that industries or companies are thinking we're going into a recession, they cut back. First place they cut back is all temporary labor. Temporary labor is let go. They either let them go, they hold back on bringing them in. They're not quick to hire, and quick to hire is temp to perm. Permanent placement. So temp to what we call temp to perm. So that's why we've been seeing it. It is exactly what you're saying is because everybody is anticipating that slowdown. And so they're like, you know what, I'm going to hold back before I bring in or continue to have that temporary labor in my, at my workplace. So we've definitely felt it. And we're hoping that at the end of 2023, going into 24, we're seeing stronger signs of 2024 being better for us. So I hope that is what we're going to see going forward.
Now, we've seen about a 12% pullback in the hiring rate since the Fed started raising interest rates. At the same time, we've seen about a 21% fall in job openings from the Fed's first movement last summer. And we've seen about a 20% increase in layoffs. So all three of those things don't bode well for the staffing industry, as you point out. Now, we've seen most of those level off. We've actually seen a pullback in the rate of layoffs here as we've moved from second quarter to third quarter. And we've seen a leveling off, if you will, of both the hiring rate and the level of job openings. I actually saw job openings peak up in the last monthly report that just came out a week or so ago. And that adds a bit of a silver lining for me for 2024.
Good, good. Well, you brought up something that is part of my next question. And it's funny because I get the pleasure of listening to you almost every other week on your forecast. And I remember at the beginning of the year, you were almost at what you felt that the Fed would be at. I think one more hike is where you thought we would end up at. And I thought, gosh, I hope he's not right. So I guess my next question is, we've already saw four hits this year. We've got two more meetings. We have one meeting hitting at the end of the month here, October 31st and the 1st of November, and then another one in December. What is your forecast on what Federal Reserve will do?
I think given the strength that we have seen in employment markets, the lack, broadly speaking, of course, unemployment rate at 3.8%, that's pretty much where the Fed is concentrated. They're not looking through the lens that we are in the staffing industry of saying these industries are good, these industries not good. So they're seeing broad strength in the employment markets. They've seen a resumption of labor force participation to levels that are almost where we were pre-pandemic. They're seeing inflation come down, but not yet at target. And they're seeing the consumer holding up fairly well. Wage growth is pretty flat. We're not seeing any sort of wage price spiral emerge like we did in the mid-1970s. So I think all of those things embolden the Fed to say we've got room to raise rates more if we want to push inflation lower. If the Fed is really committed to this idea of 2% being the natural rate of inflation or their targeted rate of inflation, that last mile, if you will, is going to be difficult for the Fed to push us to. And they either need to push really hard, which means more rate increases, or they need to trust that over time it's going to get there. And I think their fear is that if they take the foot off the pedal on the restrictive policy, they will see a wage price spiral emerge. They will see the economy reaccelerate pretty quickly. They establish this every other meeting cadence, skipping June, hiking in July, skipping September, and now we're running up to November. My question is, at this point, is not if we get another hike necessarily. I think it's just a question of timing, whether they do it at the November 1st meeting or they wait till mid-December. Okay. They have not seen a lot of additional data from September to November. And I think that's why futures market probabilities are still sitting on the fence, whether the Fed moves November or December. And I'd say I'm probably in that 60-40 camp that it's December, but it's pretty even odds at this point.
I was going to ask you what the odds are, because you usually are pretty, you have that pretty well hit on the market. When we say, okay, it's October 31st, November 1st, what's the odds? You'll say, oh, it's 90%, whatever. And you're always right, it seems like. So have they give us the odds yet on that? Is it hitting lower for November and more for December?
Yeah, right now, the odds look like it is more December than November, but they are changing almost by the day. And the advantage to looking at futures market data is it changes intraday and it changes by the day. Just taking a look at where they think the futures market is going to end up for November and December, we currently sit in terms of Fed funds rate with a, let's call it a 90% probability we're holding serve for November, and that December we're looking at and maybe a 68% probability it goes up. So by the end of the year, we're likely to be sitting at that at one step higher on the Fed's chart.
And then are we looking in 2024 that finally gradually see us come down again?
I think the last couple months have forestalled the idea that we're going to see rapid rate cuts from the Fed in 2024. I think the more likely scenario is the Fed hikes one or two more times, including maybe one hike in the early part of 2024 before they take their foot completely off the pedal and wait. I would anticipate it's towards the end of 2024 before we really start to see the Fed move rates lower. If they do, okay. I think the idea of higher for longer needs to be one that everybody gets comfortable with. And we have seen a decided move in the bond market over the last 45 days or so at the long end of the bond market's yield curve that in effect indicates to me that market participants are capitulating to the idea that the Fed is in fact going to be higher for longer, that this might look like the mid-1990s where we saw rates stay at their zenith for 2.5 years before the Fed really started to back off on policy. I think the Fed is comfortable leaving them high for a long period of time.
Interesting. So I just came back last week. I was at the American Staffing Association, the national conference. We had 1,800 of us there. And it was interesting. There was a lot of talk, a couple different things. The political turmoil that's going on in the U.S., political turmoil going around the world. The auto union strike, the auto strikers. And then all of a sudden you had a situation in Israel over this last weekend. What is all this turmoil? What's the impact that we should see for the U.S. economy going forward?
And that's a great question. The things we can't control. So we've talked a lot about things that the Fed can control. They can control interest rates. They're trying to control inflation. They try as the best they can to control employment markets, at least on a macro scale. You can't control those bolts from the blue, those geopolitical events, those things that happen outside the economic cycle. We can even cast our mind back to the war in Ukraine that started some time ago. Those events we can't control, but we do react to. As we've seen in terms of reactions in global markets, both to the situation in Israel and preceding it, the situation in Ukraine, those conflicts around the world can destabilize markets for a short period of time. Generally, the case is those events will stabilize markets for a period of 3 days to 3 weeks. And then the market accepts that is the condition it deals with. And you usually see a recovery. That recovery lasts somewhere between 4 weeks and 3 months. We've not seen a huge move in the stock markets around the world here in aggregate, given the situation in Israel. I think that specific situation is contained to the state of Israel currently. There are scenarios obviously on the table that if that becomes a broader conflict, a regional conflict, and the United States has moved a military presence into the area, if that does occur in terms of flaring up into a larger conflict, I think we see a larger impact both in markets and frankly, economic impact. on the economic impact front, the UAW strike likely is not long-term impactful to U.S. GDP. Mm-hmm. Those type of things that we look at, labor strikes, labor shortages, labor changes, certainly very impactful to the auto industry. I think there are follow-on impacts to the manufacturing companies that supply the auto industry. Obviously, if you're not putting cars together, you don't need as many parts to put cars together. Mm-hmm. So there are domino effects there that folks within the staffing industry certainly should be aware of, particularly if you are operating within the state of Michigan or other areas around the country that are predominantly economically focused on the auto industry or parts for the auto industry. As that resolves itself, though, that does not look like a broad GDP level impact. I think the post 2008-09 condition for the auto manufacturers here in the United States is one of global competition, and their global competitors have really already stepped into the gap. Those Japanese and European auto manufacturers have stepped in with incentives and other things to get folks that were thinking, maybe I'll just wait till this resolves and buy my U.S. car. And they're flipping and buying Toyotas and BMWs and other things. The one that worries me a little bit more is the current political situation in the United States, given the Congress stands at a standstill, unable to really do anything in terms of appropriations bills. Was happy to see them kick the can down the road on a government shutdown, but that November 17th date is looming very, very large, with no one in the speaker's chair in the House, with Congress effectively unable to conduct business. I think they were in session for 2 minutes yesterday,
right,
to hold a brief vote. That will become impactful if and when we hit the government shutdown. Now, that doesn't mean long-term economic impact. We've seen government shutdowns before. When the government shuts down in the past, the average is about 4 days. Mm-hmm. So I likely think we would, if we shut down, we go well over the average here. Mm-hmm. But any economic impact would be short term in nature. It's mostly through the government not paying the salaries of government workers. Government workers make up a large percentage of workers in the United States.
Right.
Not paying government workers means they don't spend money. Consumer driven economy, consumers not spending money. It likely is a meaningful impact to the fourth quarter GDP for the country. Now, that means it's a boost to first quarter GDP, because right, once it gets resolved, the government does pay back pay.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a furlough type situation or a layoff type situation where you're just not going to pay folks like we saw during the pandemic. You let staff go. 90 days later, you're calling them back. That scenario doesn't work for the government. The government just doesn't pay the staff until they come back, and then they get their back pay. So that back pay is important from an economic perspective, that it rights the ship the quarter after it's resolved.
Mm-hmm.
We can get into polarization and the pending election next year as a factor too, but those would be more medium term impacts.
Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Thank you. When we were talking about the UAW, it's surprising how much of the staffing industry really supports automotive in, as a second supplier. Really, I mean, we, Tricom, has many clients that actually are supplying the for the second suppliers. So it's really interesting. And we were talking last week at the show about it. And the concern is, and I'd love to find out what your feeling is, because student loans kick back in. The student loans, all that that was sitting there for a long period of time since COVID, none of those payments were being made. And someone made the correlation that, well, now student loans are having to be paid. Don't you think that all these cars that were being bought, people looking to buy cars, these individuals in their late 20s, early 30s, the car demand is going to go down? How is that impact? And I'm like, I didn't think about that. And that didn't seem like a concern for me.
Well, we're already dealing with a bit of a headwind for car purchasing and leasing. Because those reference rates, because of the Fed's significant action from the midpoint of last year forward, have really changed the financing dynamic for most people.
Right.
Financing has become a much bigger component of buying cars. I think I can remember the first car I bought on my own was a 3-year loan. And that was not too far off the average. The average now is between 7 and 8 years for an auto loan. And part of that is just the purchase price of the car. Part of it is car manufacturers finding a way to get us into cars that are a little bit less affordable in the short term and more affordable in the long term. The reality, though, is if those rates just change from 2.75% or 3.5% to 7-8% for those car loans, we've already impacted the affordability index for individuals wanting to buy or lease a car. Now you throw on the additional saddle for those that are in their prime spending years, those, you know, 25 to 54, that they're now going to have to resume paying student loan debt that takes up somewhere between half and three quarters of what would be a car payment. Mm-hmm. And now you're talking about a meaningful change in consumer behavior with those two things being in play. So I would be watching auto sales pretty closely. We watch auto sales closely as a recessionary indicator anyway. It's usually one of the first areas you see consumers change their shopping behavior is in big ticket purchases for autos. I would imagine that we see a little bit more upward pressure in the short term on the used car market, people looking for more affordability. That doesn't last very long because there's a finite supply. Mm-hmm. So we would likely see some sort of slowdown in the auto world next year. I think you can actually already see some of the automakers getting prepared for it. Some of them are offering more attractive financing for 72 months. And we're not quite to zero for 72 again, mm-hmm. but you're seeing a number of automakers taking the rate down in effect and offering through their own captive financing organizations 2.9%, 1.9% APR on a 72-month loan, just trying to make sure they still get people into the cars, right, given all this other turmoil.
Interesting. Well, thank you. That's interesting. Here's a question. What is the media not talking about that's important for us to know? Because, you know, they only talk about the stuff that they want to scare us about.
Sure. The media likes to talk about things to scare us about. And they're, you know, we've talked about a lot of them. There's a lot of things to scare us about. I think there's a lot there that gets unsaid that is on the positive side, too. I think if we paint a scenario of what happens in the event of an economic slowdown and whether we cross zero or not, and we call it a recession, we call it a soft landing, to me is almost irrelevant. If we get what I think is a controlled economic slowdown, meaning we're somewhere between, you know, less than 1% GDP growth and 2% GDP contraction. So somewhere in that range, soft landing or recession, that's the economy slowing down. I think that that's normal and natural from a cyclical perspective. We have certainly seen companies on a default rate basis much lower than they've been in any other decade over the last decade, even with the disruption of the pandemic. Those low rates of default mean that either A, companies are much better funded, much better prepared from a balance sheet perspective, or they've been getting cheap financing for a long time and being able to kick the can. Mm-hmm. I think those that have been getting cheap financing and kicking the can likely start to go out of business at a higher rate. So even if we see default rates jump up on debt, even if we see bankruptcy rates rise, which we've actually already started to see here at the midpoint of this year, you know, we will see businesses emerge much stronger from this on the other side. And I think that's one of the areas that the staffing industry can rest on your laurels a little bit. To say in prior cyclical recessions, and this is based just on the business cycle, those firms that are well prepared typically start staffing up before the economy turns. They mm-hmm. see the opportunity, they've taken care of themselves from a balance sheet perspective, and they are ready to start taking market share away from competitors that maybe have been on life support because they've been getting cheap debt.
Right.
That competitive dynamic actually works very well for those in the staffing world, because the only way those businesses can scale quickly is to use manpower to do it. Mm-hmm. You can't have a 3-year capital improvement project at the rates we're at today to come online and add another production line. You're going to just throw a second shift on. Mm-hmm. And to do that, you need to find people, you need to find them quickly, you need to take advantage of the opportunity, sort of strike while the iron's hot. And I think those opportunities are going to be there in 2024, particularly if it's a soft landing or even in the recessionary scenario. So if we're thinking our highest probability event is a recession starting sometime mid next year, lasting 6 to 8 months, not very long at all. So a brief dip below zero, really a blip for a well-prepared company. They start staffing by the end of summer. Pretty quickly. If it's a soft landing and that becomes evident, they start staffing in the spring.
Right.
And either of those scenarios are broadly positive for the staffing industry. It means, depending on your industry, you may see a little bit of pickup. If you're in medical services, for example, you might see a pickup much sooner.
Right.
If you're in technology, a number of those companies actually reacted sooner. And you saw those layoffs at the end of 2022. You saw a number of those companies in the first quarter say in their earnings releases, man, we're going to stop hiring. Mm-hmm. We're just not going to hire. What we've seen in the last 3 months is a decided turnaround in hiring in for technology companies. Many of them realizing, whoops, we moved too quickly. We moved too aggressively. We need to get people back without making a bunch of noise. We need to get people back before our competitors start taking advantage of us.
Right.
And some of those large technology companies have actually started adding to headcount.
Right, right. The one area we have not seen any type of slowdown is construction, skilled labor in construction. They have been just doing gangbusters. They just, you know, 20% increase, 30% increase, outstanding year they've had.
The last year for the construction industry, they're actually the number two industry in terms of job growth. Number one is leisure and hospitality, right? Everybody's going to spend money on travel. They're up about 9%. Construction's up about 5%. If you look at the pre-COVID period, the largest growing industry was actually construction, mm-hmm. but they were growing at 2.8% annual rate. So they're growing at more than or almost double their pre-COVID annual rate of growth right now over the last year.
Wow. And then your comment with a strong balance sheet, and that for the staffing owners, what we've been seeing now is consolidation. A lot of acquisitions going on now because some people weren't prepared for this slowdown and they weren't, you know, doing the right things with their money, taking it all out, not saving it for the rainy day, for the, you know, because we have bad days, we have bad times in the industry. So what we're seeing a lot of now is consolidation, which can be good for some of us, some of the clients, and I love that. And for others, it's maybe time for retirement. You know, it's, they've said, I've had enough with the COVID and everything, it's time to retire. So, well, it'll be interesting to see how many, how much consolidation happens over the next 6 to 9 months in the industry. So what I don't know how much you can put in your insight on this, but there's a lot of legislation going around the country that's really been impactful to staffing. Pay transparency, equity, immigration, nurse staffing legislation. Just those are just a few of the major ones impacting. Any insight you can, in your opinion on this and how much more we'll see? Because it's been a real volatile year in 2023. For these legislation that have been occurring in all different states?
I think anytime you have a persistent condition of outside of equilibrium, so you don't have supply and demand matching up, you have folks try to legislate your way back to equilibrium, if you will. And we've seen that over the last 3+ years and the post-COVID condition of more labor demand than supply. So there you will see angst, you will see people kind of tossing and turning, and then all of a sudden the politicians get involved and they will try to force the issue. So I think you're seeing that in some of the legislation, that you're trying to see right sizing of industries, trying to see incentives created for folks to enter certain industries. I think you're also seeing incentives for business owners to have more employee-friendly practices in some cases and less employee-friendly practices in other places. Mm-hmm. You look at some of the labor disruptions that we've seen, and they're not simply just about pay. You know, we look at the UAW, look at the Kaiser Permanente issue in California for the healthcare space. Both of those are driven more or less by pay plus issues, right? It's not simply just pay, it's work conditions, it's benefits, it's other things that, given the health of companies over the post-COVID period, employees are seeking to get their share of the pie, so to speak. If you look at wage growth versus inflation over the last 3 years, it's effectively flat to down on a real basis. The average American worker has actually taken a pay cut over the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. That sort of condition does not play well to a political constituency, and it doesn't play well to organized labor. So in those situations, you do have a lot of strife. That strife tends to breed these situations like we see now, where you're trying to legislate your way out of it. Mm-hmm. And maybe a little bit of personal opinion, but a little bit of economic fact behind it. Generally, the economy does better when we stay out of its way. Mm-hmm. Trying to over-legislate, try to put too many guardrails and force things into a funnel doesn't really work out well in the long term. It may work in the short term, but the long-term implications usually need to be resolved through further legislation or repealing legislation or things like that. So from my perspective, I think you've got a lot of noise going on right now. Mm-hmm. I don't think, given the level of polarization across the country, that unless you're talking about very localized laws and rule changes where you do have a strong political majorities, think, for example, the city of Chicago. You don't have a lot of political capital to expend to get something passed on a broader scale, and those typically don't last.
Yeah. Our message to a lot of the to our owners is get involved in your state associations, get your voice heard. I do a lot with the PAC funds in all the states and really start to get out to speaking to the Congress, get out and walk the floors, talk to them, let them understand what an impact a change will be to our industry, to the owners, and how it impacts not just the owners, but the individuals we're servicing, the employees we're servicing. So a lot of times they don't know what they're doing. They just don't understand the impact of it.
That's true. If one side is noisy and the other side is quiet, it's pretty easy to pass legislation supporting the noisy side. If there is noise on both sides, it's very hard to find something that is very punitive for one side or the other. It usually ends up watered down in some sort of middle ground, or the issue actually goes away.
Okay. I guess I would like to end with is there any other information, advice, that you would like to share for any staffing owners?
Sure. In terms of takeaways, in terms of where we go from here and things we need to be aware of, I think it's the global economy's held up pretty well through most of what we've experienced this year, better than we all expected. In that type of situation, you've got to think that a soft landing is a real possibility next year, shallow recession, real possibility next year. The underscore there is continue to manage your business on a conservative basis. Continue to make good, solid, long-term decisions and be ready to strike when an opportunity presents itself. Whether it's an acquisition, if you're a well-capitalized business with good long-term plans, this is an excellent environment, even with higher valuations on businesses, to take that next step in expanding your reach. Because when things turn, because when you're on the other side of the economic cycle and we're back into a growth phase, economically speaking, you're now much more apt to take advantage of those opportunities. And even if it's not acquisition, even if it's positioning yourself into new areas, even if it's reaching beyond your kind of core competency and saying, maybe I'm going to do a little bit more in a new industry, diversify a little bit. Diversification is a big one for us, both in terms of investment portfolios, but also in terms of business portfolios. The more diversified business lines are going to lead to better success in the future. And then the last one, we like to prognosticate and come up with ideas of timing. And sure, maybe my percentages have been right in the most recent time period here. But the reality is there's a lot of unknown out there. And when you're dealing with an environment where there's a lot of unknown, where there's a lot of uncertainty, making good, solid, long-term decisions is the right path forward. It's the right step to take. Don't take a huge amount of risk in this type of environment, because there are too many bolt from the blue type opportunities to destabilize that choice. Yeah. It's a good time to be a good, solid, conservative business owner.
So true. And my message is really watch your AR. Don't let stuff go out. Don't give more time to your clients, because that client that you thought, that customer you thought was a solid customer, could easily be hurting and had a turn. And they went from 30 to 60 to 75 days, could be filing bankruptcy the next day. So
that's great advice. I think you saw that with the Fitch downgrade of the United States in terms of the amount of debt. You'll find no better payee than the United States of America never having defaulted on our debt. But for a rating agency to downgrade us, it's simply because of the large amount of debt that needs to be refinanced over the coming years. Businesses absolutely sit in that same situation. So if you were dealing with an AR situation with what you think is a high quality business, you don't know if that high quality business is built on borrowing at really cheap rates. Right. I think the change in business lending rates has gone from 2% to 8.5% on average nationally just over the last 9 months. And with that change, you have to imagine most businesses don't have 9 month debt. Mm-hmm. And most businesses have debt that's a little beyond that. So that refinancing risk for them is not there yet. And when it hits, you will definitely see them enter a stressful period when they weren't stressful before.
Right. Well, excellent. Thank you. Well, that concludes this month's podcast on the economic forecast. Thank you, Jason. I really appreciate it. And you're always very insightful. You always have great information. Join me next month when I speak with Tom Erb, and his information will be the state of the staffing industry and what to look for in 2024. Until then, thank you for joining me and Insight with Insiders.